So first things first, I wanted to say that this thing is, as you know, I'm going to be drawing you.
Yes.
This, it's just for entertainment. And the other thing is, I want to let everybody know this is not an interview. You know, it's not intended to be an interview. There's many, many nice interviews online with Yari. Everybody, I recommend to go see those. This is, you know, my intention with these programs of chat and draw was to imagine myself in my studio and an artist friend or musician friend or anyone comes and visits me in my studio. And we just chat and exchange ideas and talk about what we're doing. You know, simple stuff like that. You know, it's like, you know, if Van Gogh or went to visit Gauguin, you know, they're not going to interview each other. You know, they're just going to, I don't know who Van Gogh and who's Gauguin in this case, but Yari, definitely a Van Gogh.
I'm not doing anything to my ears. First of all, thank you very much for inviting me. I'm very honored. Thank you, Dariush.
My pleasure. Sorry about this echo. Is
still there?
So, try to maybe turn this up a little bit. Yari, you said in some of your interviews, I noticed you say that, you know, when you go to the studio to start your work, you go into a state of zen or treat it as you need to free yourself from all the inputs.
Right.
So tell me, how do you do that? Do you have a method or is it just something that you created on your own?
No, I mean, after many years, it becomes second nature. This is the way I work. I try to be as empty as possible when I go there and become a vessel, basically, for this energy to come through. This is something that happened early on in my career as an artist, and I was amazed by the results. And then I realized that the more I let myself get out of the way, the more solid, stronger, and fluid it is. I mean, this is something I read years later. This was Leonard Cohen's last interview, and he was asked about his creative process, and he said, I don't know, I really don't know what I'm doing. And I think the deeper you delve into something, the more years you put in, the more it happens. And your job is to get out of its way. I mean, you do your part in the conscious mind by doing a daily practice, by showing up in the studio, working, the technique you develop over the years, your knowledge of art and art history and everything around it. But when you go there to allow the work to come out, you just let it flow. And after a while, I mean, this was kind of disconcerting at first to me when I started doing that 30-something years ago. But after a while, when you see that it works, you learn to trust it more and more.
And that goes with all artistic careers, or even in general life. To be present.
Yeah, I mean, I've learned a lot of lessons from my studio that, you know, if I could just apply them to my life outside the studio, my life would be much richer outside the studio as well. No, that is very true. The studio is a very solitary, sacred space for me that allows me to do that. Life outside the studio, you know, is riddled with a lot of distractions that sometimes get in the way. Sometimes you can overcome them. Sometimes, you know.
So that aspect right there, the Zen and meditation and, you know, spirituality is very interesting to me. And I, you know, I'm a big follower of that. And, you know, my daily thoughts are always around that.
Mm-hmm.
You know, finding, you know, questioning life and my existence in this world.
Right. Well, the main questions that we've always had all our lives, you know, who we are, where we've come from, what we're doing here, that those are always with us. And I must say, I don't really particularly meditate outside the studio. I mean, my work is my meditation. I mean, I have a hard time getting myself to sit down and meditate, while when I go to the studio, it just happens by itself.
Yeah.
You know? And this is interesting, like, it makes me wonder, do I even need to try to sit to meditate? For example, you know, the textures that you see in my work developed over many years, I was always fond of encaustic work, you know, working with beeswax and pigments. And it's kind of a messy undertaking. You need to have a good ventilated studio because of the smell. You couldn't be in like a group shared studio. Other people would complain about it. And then I realized, I mean, I'm already doing the kind of things I would like to do with encaustic. And I've arrived at it in my own way over the years. Do I need to even go there? You know? So it became a moot issue, basically.
Yeah. And so that in itself, you know, being present and in a state of Zen is just fantastic encouragement to go to the studio.
Yes, indeed. I mean, from years ago, even, you know, when I started, my work was figurative. And it kind of tended to go towards surrealism at that time. And then with time, the figures started becoming less materialized, should I say. And they started fading away. And I was much more carefree in the background of the works. And then I realized that I'm more interested in what's going on in the background. And that's what drew me in. And my work from there on gradually became more non-figurative, abstract. And one thing we should say, we don't have any plans for this talk. If I'm all over the place, you know, we discussed this already, that, you know, we'll just let it go wherever it wants to go. And my mind sometimes does that.
Exactly. And I told you before when we talked, it's kind of like your paintings, you know.
Very true.
Then go explore and let the painting dictate.
Exactly. You know, and a lot of things kind of join together to take me in that direction. For example, the fact that I work in oil, and I love to work with oil. And with oil, when you work in layers, or just in general, you have to wait for something to dry so you can work on it further. And I couldn't just wait for a week or 2 weeks for something to dry. So I started working on multiple pieces at a time, you know. And so I always have something to work on. There are times that I work on maybe 50 pieces at a time, but it doesn't mean that every day I work on 50 paintings. I work on something, set it aside, and keep working on something. I may get stuck in it. I set it aside. Meanwhile, in the back of my mind, that problem is percolating. Is the answer for it is percolating, is being worked on. And another painting might show me the way to solve that problem on that painting. So they're always like talking to each other. And over time, I realized that another good gift that gave me was that not to be involved with a painting, but with the process of painting.
Right.
You know, years ago, somebody asked me this, what is your favorite painting of yours? And I responded without hesitation, and I surprised myself with that. I said, whatever I'm working on at the moment. And that's very true. That's the main engagement. It doesn't mean that you don't care or for or not engaged with the other pieces, but they have their own life. And once they're finished, you know, they're like children who go on and have their own lives and occasionally call you or send a postcard, but they have their own life and you focus on the next work.
I love that.
Yeah, and that in itself, you, when you say that the painting that you're working at right now, isn't that, there was the little children's book, I think, called Three Questions. I don't know if you've seen it. There's the art, the...
I don't know. You know.
The person who wrote it is also an illustrator. He does beautiful watercolor paintings. I don't remember his name. But, but these three questions that are like Zen questions, they ask, you know, what is the best thing to do? And the answer is what you're doing right now. And right. When is the best time to do it? Right now.
Right. Exactly. Yeah.
Who do I do it with? The person you're with right now.
Exactly. To be aware, to be in the moment. Yeah. Right.
So you, the painting that you're working right now is the one that I think Lucian Freud used to say he wants his last painting to be the best painting in the world, you know, so that when he dies after that.
Well, that's a very loaded sentence. I don't know about that myself. I want it to be the most complete thing that I can make at that moment, yeah. You know, as a self supporting entity, and so that painting doesn't need anything else from outside, you know. I don't know, but the most beautiful in the world is, first of all, such a thing does not exist. And then egos have different sizes, you know. Lucian Freud is a wonderful painter, but I'm not sure it would be fun to go drinking with him. Francis Bacon, on the other hand, would be fun to go drinking with him.
And that was actually, I was thinking about that, you know, the fact that he was drunk all the time, well, most of the time, you know. And was getting old too.
You mean
kind of?
What, you mean Freud?
Bacon.
Oh, yeah. There's this wonderful documentary that is shot within the course of a day, maybe, or a few days. But anyway, the way it's edited also, he just gets progressively more and more drunk throughout the documentary, while by the end, he's like falling off the table, almost, basically.
But, that's the other thing. I've noticed too many things going on in my head at the same time. I noticed that you and I are both the same age.
Yes, I was amazed by that. We came here around the same time, same age, and basically had parallel lives in some ways.
Exactly. We'll get into that later. But, you know, I wanted to bring up the issue of age and getting older.
Right.
And Bacon being drunk and getting older and older, I wonder how he would manage performing in the studio. Because I notice right now when I'm painting, you know, my wrist hurts, my fingers hurt. You know, it's not, I was not the same as I was, you know, 30 years ago.
Well, true. But you do what you have to do. You find a way. You know? I mean, speaking of Bacon, I love his studio. And whenever I get studio envy looking at somebody like Gerhard Richter's studio, then I think of Bacon's studio. And remind myself that it's not about the studio or the size of it or how wonderful it is. It's what you can do in it, yeah. You know. And it's interesting, in Francis Bacon's studio, no broom or vacuum cleaner had touched that floor for like 30, 40 years. I try to be a little more cleanly in my studio, but you figure out a way. You find a way to do it. Like Chuck Close, after he had his accident, you know, he kept on working on the wheelchair, and you just find a way. Unless, I mean, there are people, you know, who some have lost the use of their hands, and they learn to work with their feet. It's quite amazing.
So it forces you to find new ways and new tools and a new way of looking at things. And
yeah, it has to do with that devotion, you know. It's this is something you have to do, and you find a way to do it as best as possible. Your work may need to change to accommodate that, but again, you do what you need to do, you know. I think we were going to talk about this age. I think my studio discipline these days is very good. In the past few years, I've been very, very strict about it, show up as much as possible and work even when I'm not feeling like working. And I wasn't like that when I was younger. You know, I would go to the studio when I felt like working. With the time, I realized that it's not about that. It's you work. You basically shut up and work. And whatever good's going to come out of it, will come out of it that way. And it, I learned not to believe in that kind of 19th century idea of waiting around for the muse to come and kiss your cheeks or bang you on the head. But that's like Picasso said, you know, it comes from work, it comes from studio. So how would I get to that one? Oh, we were talking about age. Yeah, you know, I've been dealing with some health issues too in the past few years. I smoked for many years, and not anymore because I can't. I do miss it, but I can't really. I had a heart attack a few years ago, had a stent put in. And then for the past few years, I've been dealing with bladder cancer, which is a finicky one. It's not fatal, it's not lethal, but it comes and goes. And it's just kind of like something one has to deal with for the rest of one's life. Occasional chemotherapy is needed, occasional operation is needed. And I wonder if the kind of this kind of studio devotion I have now, how much of it has to do with mortality and facing mortality. I'm not sure. I don't really want to dwell on that. I just know that I have to work. I can't not work. I mean, I'm very off-centered when I'm not working. I love traveling, but when I'm traveling for a while and not in my studio, I start getting very agitated. You know? So I find it both uplifting and grounding at the same time when I'm working.
So you found this urge to be in the studio and work a little bit more after...
I can't say that for sure. I think it might just, they just kind of coincided in a way. Is it because of that? I can't really tell, because this kind of discipline that I have now started way before that. Well, one can say that was a premonition, but I, you know, that's open wide for interpretation. Oh, I have to keep my pose, sorry.
Actually, I'm. Don't worry, Yari. I'm looking at your picture on my desktop.
Ah, okay.
Mention that too. I decided to do that because a lot of guests just move around a lot, and then also the pictures get pixelated. And it's too tiny for me to look at.
Oh, I see. Okay. So,
you know, maybe in the future I'll just ask my guests to send me a photo.
Okay. I've been trying to sit very still, but no problem.
Yeah, so we about urgency, aging, health issues, and what about fear? Does fear come anywhere in there?
Which kind of fear? There are many different kinds an artist deals with throughout their life.
But it's just fear of death.
No, No, I've never been fearful of death. I'm fearful of pain. I don't like pain. And I think my threshold for pain is not very high. Death, fine. I'm fine with it. I look forward actually to what's on the other side, whether it's nothingness or something, you know, which is still up for debate. So, no, the fear is for most of my life, as many artists, was trying to survive. You know, that whole dichotomy between fulfillment and survival that you're forced to deal with as an artist here, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, problems that the artists in Iran deal with are very different types of problems, but you see a lot of people that, you know, if they have financial problems, they can go and live in the relative's house or this and that. We don't have such luxuries here to be able to do that. You are easily a couple of paychecks away from being homeless in this country.
This is true.
You know, if you're not a high paid professional. And these are choices we make early in life. You know, you and I both went to the same universities that these people who make a lot of money went to, but we chose to go after something that we thought would give meaning to our lives. Now, I'm not saying that their lives are meaningless. I'm just saying that different choices and different effects. The fear was always that I have had a lot of day jobs, you know, as an artist, and from very simple menial jobs to high tech jobs over the years. Mm-hmm. And yet, you know, like in the past 10 years or so, I decided to tighten my belt and just focus on my art. And it hasn't been easy. There's been some great highs and there have been some scary moments, but overall I'm very happy I've been doing that.
But you've been working as an artist since early 90s, no?
You dropped out since when?
Early 90s?
Yes. I mean, alongside of other things I was doing, like when I was working and as a web designer full-time and maintaining a studio and painting, there were people who didn't realize that. They came to me and said, I have no idea you had a full-time job. We thought you were a trust fund baby or something. Because of how much I worked and, you know, how much I painted, they thought that's all I did. But I had no life outside the studio and work, basically, at that time. But my priorities were survival and painting. You know, so no, I mean, since then I've been painting nonstop, and because I just love bringing these things into the world, or being part of them being brought out into the world. You know.
So, but right now. You're not doing any other work other than painting?
No, not for the past 10 years, no.
What, 10 years? Okay.
Yeah.
And that, I'm surprised you say, wow, that is something to say, that you say that is more fearful than death itself.
Well, I mean, why should death be fearful? I have no fear of death. It's pain. It's pain is what I fear. I mean, death happens. At the moment, you know, death is hard for people who love you who are not dead. And, but it happens quickly, and whatever happens, it has happened. But pain is something that can be prolonged. That I don't like. Death, yeah. I mean, I don't want to hasten it, but, you know, it comes when it comes.
I fear being away from my family.
You fear death away from your family?
No, I fear not having my family around, my daughters, my family. Ah. I mean, my wife, my parents, your dear ones. I just imagine, like, you know, if they, I don't know, put me in prison or something, you know, for 10 years, you know, being from my family, that's, I fear for that. I want to be anything that will takes me away from them, fills me with fear.
No, that's understandable, especially since you have a child. You have only one daughter? One?
No, actually, I got three. I got three. Two daughters. You have two daughters?
No. So you have this extension into the future. I don't. All my extensions are these, you know, into the future. No, I don't have children. No, you probably saw pictures of me and with my niece and nephews online, but yeah.
Sorry, I assume you that's
another thing we can talk about also, because I mean, I was never close to the idea of having children, but as an artist, I thought I wanted to be in a kind of a stable situation, to be able to lay the foundation for that. And so that was always kind of up in the air. But other people tell me, of course, that you don't have to wait for that, and you do it, and you do whatever you can do, and the rest falls into place. Well, I didn't go after it when I should have, and now it's a little too late for that age-wise, mm-hmm. You know? And that's what I wanted to talk about.
Yeah, it's in a way it's a blessing, because you have one less worry.
I don't know. I mean, the grass is always greener on the other side, isn't it? There are arguments for both sides of that.
This is true. Yeah. So, what are you working on right now?
I'm working on, like I said, many pieces at the same time. I probably have like 60 things going here. A couple of larger pieces, a few medium ones, some small ones, and some tiny ones, like 8 by 10 inches. They're all in various degrees of completion, of course. This is one of the larger ones that I'm working on now.
What is that, like a 4 by 5 or something?
No, that's 4 by 5 feet. Yes. Yeah. Let me see.
You can't really see the
texture. You gotta go close, you know.
Yeah, you know, your painting.
Yeah, you're dropping out. Say that again.
I'm saying, with your paintings, photographs don't do them justice.
No, because the fine textures don't really come through. But that usually works to my benefit, that if people like my work online, they're really blown over when they see them in person, because they look much nicer in person. So in that way, it works for me. I think only once that happened the other way around with one person, but the rest of the time, yeah, it's there's nothing you can do about that. Sometimes you can have like detailed shots of textures, but yeah, you do what you have to do.
Yeah.
You're dropping out more and more, the audio.
What about now?
Now it's okay.
So I was saying, I noticed that your paintings are different, various sizes. Like you said, large ones, medium ones, small ones.
Right.
Like, do you have, offhand, what was the largest one that you've ever worked at?
The largest one was, I think, 95 by 79 or 80.
That's a good size.
That's a very good size, but I mean, it causes a lot of problems in terms of storage and moving it around, this and that. I mean, I finally took it off the stretcher bars and rolled it up and used the stretcher, cut it down, used it for other paintings, because it's just too big. That's another thing. Storage is a problem, you know. But as far as why I work in different sizes, that came from my student days, where I was a broke art student and I would paint on whatever I could get my hands on. You know, so the sizes didn't matter. And I would even be in the wood shop at the school and gathering up little pieces of wood that people would throw away, glue them together, make longer pieces and make stretcher bars out of those. I still have some of them and those are like 30 years old. They're still holding up.
Also of sales, because you know there are people looking for smaller paintings.
Oh yeah, that works too. I mean, so, but there is no rhyme or reason for sales. It's very strange. Sometimes people gravitate towards the small works. Sometimes a couple of big ones are sold. Sometimes you think that some smaller ones, because they're more affordable, would sell more of or more easily. Not necessarily.
Right.
Sometimes, I mean, recently I'm waiting for it to be finalized, but I've sold probably the most expensive one that I've sold so far.
Mm.
Yeah.
Great.
Yeah. Waiting. It's almost finalized. I'm just waiting for it before I announce it. I'm excited about it, but I have to kind of hold it back to make sure it's done.
What's your one?
Pardon?
Your most recent sale?
Yeah, this is the most recent sale. Yeah.
Can we see it or no?
It's not here. I can't show it to you now. It's in New York right now. I mean, it's at the collector's home now. I can send you the photo online, yeah. But I can't really say it's sold until, like I said, they, you know, do the final sign-off on it. But it's in process. Bless you.
Thank you. So it is at their pace, and they have giving it a try.
Yeah.
And I haven't even looked at my one thing I wanted to know is when I was asking you about the size of your in terms of transporting them to shows, you know, like large pieces, but you take them off the frame and then roll them up.
You mean to sell or to
for
store?
You know, but sometimes you have shows where you have to, it's not in your city, you have to send
it. Right. Oh, depends. I have done both. I mean, last two shows in Los Angeles, for example, I rented a U-Haul and drove the paintings there myself.
Mm.
Like an 8-hour drive with a truck and then, you know, drive them back when the show was over. So I've done a lot of that. And you try to also organize shows in a way that they kind of overlap or work with each other. I had a couple of shows in Italy some years ago, and they were able to keep the pieces there after the show. So from there, I got into this show in Germany. And just the fact that I had the pieces in Europe made them to be more open to it, and because they could more easily be shipped. So I had the show there, and from there I worked with a gallery in London, so the pieces were shipped from Germany to London. And when they were done, they were sent to New York.
Wow.
Where my cousin was keeping them for me in his garage. And then when I found a show in New York, I went and did that. after that, there was a show in DC, your area. This is the Georgetown show at Syrah. Yeah. And so I went to New York. I rented an SUV, got those pieces, drove them to DC. So you try to kind of plan things so they kind of work with each other. And sometimes you take them off the stretcher bar, you roll them and ship them. Sometimes just like they are. I mean, some of the bigger collectors, like this latest one, she wanted to pay for the shipping.
Mm.
And the shipping cost was more than the price of some other pieces I've sold. Thousands of dollars just for shipping.
Was that that, or just one that you've done, right?
Yeah, this is this latest one, yeah. And, but, so, you never know. Just as shows, you never know. I mean, you show somewhere where you are confident that you will sell a lot of work, and you don't. And then you show somewhere that you think, oh, I'm not going to sell much here. And then you sell a lot of work. You never know. This is both exciting, confusing, frustrating at times. Yeah. But that's how it is. Has its own logic, which is hard to crack.
But when you roll things and send them, does that not damage them?
When I roll them?
Yeah.
No, I mean, you have to roll them in the right way. You roll them around something, first of all, around like a cardboard tube before you put them in another tube. And you have to roll them outwards, of course, you know, facing out. And of course, you can't roll everything. If there's work with a lot of impasto on it, you know, there's a chance of the paint cracking. So you have to make that judgment, what can be rolled and what cannot be rolled. And of course, sometimes I work on wood panels, and those better not be rolled.
Let's go back to, let me see what I was going to. Your name, Yari. I have to admit, I haven't heard the name Yari in Farsi.
I have only come across one other, but it's actually short for Khodayar.
Ah, okay.
Right.
Okay.
There is Khodayar and there's Meheryar that I've heard.
Your name is both Khodayar?
No. I'm just saying Yari. I've only heard for Meheryar and Khodayar. Right. Well, we are three brothers. You know, my the older brother is Khashayar. Younger one is Maziar. Of course, for short, it would be Khasha and Mazi. But if you did the same for me, they would call me Khoda, which you couldn't do for a little kid running around and, you know, climbing up the trees. So it became Yari. Otherwise, any of them could be Yari. So that's why, I mean, ever since I remember, I was called Yari.
Yeah. Talk about the Khoda. Do you have any, I mean, we talked about briefly about spirituality, but what is your viewpoint of that word?
Oh, it's the system that underlines the existence. And I don't see it as a person. I see it as energy, symbolized throughout history as a person. But unfortunately, a lot of people have taken the symbol over the actual thing. So, and it is necessary sometimes to basically materialize in a way a concept into a being so you can directly connect with them. But then you have to be aware of that's what you're doing. So, for example, the idea of fate, Sarnivish. I believe in that, but in a different way, a lot of people believe in it, because I think it's pre-written. But as long as you don't know what is written, you have no say in it. See what I mean? I mean, some people use that to justify inaction, for example. They say, well, this is my fate to be sitting here. How do you know that on the next page it doesn't say that right now you will get up and do this thing?
Mm-hmm.
You know, they will project on that. So in a way, it is written, but it is as if it is not. And so that whole notion of God is the essence of our being. It's not this old man sitting up there who would punish the creatures he has created for his mistakes, really.
And you said that the image of God is needed for people to be able to relate to this thing that we cannot define.
Right, as a symbol.
And that makes sense, because it's not a easy thing to talk about. You know, you can intellectualize about it and talk about it. But if you want to show this, like someone like Jesus, who, I mean, was enlightened, he wants to express that feeling or that people of his time. How would he talk about it?
Well, first of all, what we have from the past, whether it's with religions or anything else, just history in general, so much has been lost and so much is distorted. I mean, history is distorted. History, the first half hour is perfect. And after that, it's distorted. And, you know, I mean, Bible was put down as a book, you know, hundreds of years later after Jesus. And already, I mean, occasionally we come across other forgotten civilizations that we had no marks of in history before. So, you know, I don't know. No particular opinion on the reading of that for me, other than what I said already.
Well, let's. I think I heard in some of the talks you had that you gravitate towards Taoism and maybe even a little bit of Buddhism, Asian and East Asian philosophy and outlook. Is that the case?
Right. I guess what?
I'm saying, is that the case?
Oh, is that the case? Oh, yes, indeed. But to me, that's not such an odd thing. That is really, to me, what the poetic outlook on existence is.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And like I said, I'm not interested in Buddhism per se or Sufism per se. I'm interested, you see, the different mystic traditions in the world, where they overlap. I think that's where the kernel of truth is,
mm-hmm.
because the rest of it is you know, they're tribal or local accents or languages, really, that has been influenced by the culture and history of that region. You know, I mean, what does Islamic Sufism have to do with Native American mysticism? The parts that don't have anything to do with each other, I like to set those aside. The parts that overlap makes me want to look further and deeper into that. The same with Zen, Taoism, and other things. I mean, Hinduism, there are a lot of interesting ideas in it, but it's also rife with a lot of prejudice and violence.
Mm-hmm.
What I'm interested in is where these different mystical traditions overlap.
Yeah,
you know. So, and in a way, I mean, I've had friends who have become like from Christian to Buddhist, and basically they've taken that same zealousness that they had with one religion into another. You know, I mean, this, I wasn't at this talk, but a friend told me this was interesting. This wise person was asked at a talk whether being vegetarian helps you become nonviolent or less violent? And the speaker answered, I've seen people eat vegetables violently.
I read that, yeah.
You know? So that's why, as Groucho Marx said, yeah. In that way, I'm a Marxist, Groucho, definitely. He said, I won't be joining a club that will take me as a member. So I can't be a Buddhist, I can't be a Taoist, but I can be somewhere where I can see these overlapping parts and dwell in that.
Yeah, the thing is, you know, if any of these philosophical spiritual ways are any good or true, is that they're all talking about the same sort we cannot name.
Yes.
It's kind of like, you know, going to an art studio with 10 art students painting a still life.
Right.
And if you look at each artist's painting, it's going to be a different way of depicting that.
True. But also, it has to do with the dichotomy between experiencing of art and talking about art. Two different things. And, you know, in Tao, so it says, and I think in some old Jewish readings, I think, if I'm not mistaken, that basically the God that can be named is not God.
Right.
You know, and that kind of is like the end of discussion in those terms at that point, you know? And just like when you start talking about art and versus experiencing it, you are leaving out a lot of overtones, which then are lost, you know?
Right. But I was interested in your hearing that you were interested in Taoism, which talks about, can we talk about that a little bit?
Sure. But also I wanted to remind me of something else. Some years ago, I had a show in LA, which was an open air show in an Iranian event. And the booth next to the one I was in, the artist who was there, they were part of this, I don't know, call it a spiritual group or not exactly. And anyway, after they read my statement, says, oh, you know, your ideas match so much with what we do and what we say. And would you like to join? He said, well, if my ideas are the same, why would I join if I'm already there? You know?
Do you actually have these comebacks right at your hand, or do you think of it later?
No. Usually, they happen by themselves. No, I am a big fan of British humor and not sarcasm, but good humor is sophisticated.
I really agree. I've seen, how much time do you have, Yari?
I'm open. I have a meeting for our cooperative gallery tonight. Until then, I have many hours.
Okay, beautiful. So let's actually go over some of these fans of yours.
Oh, we have questions.
I'm going to go back and see if there's any questions. Okay. If you guys have any questions or comments, please send them. I'm going way back here to see.
Thank you for being. خیلی ممنون از همه کسایی که اومدین.
Most people are saying just came in and waved. Let's see. I don't see any questions.
سلامت باشین.
Let's see.
به هر حال این بعدن هم میتونن اینو ببینن دیگه دوست داشته باشن.
Are that's actually, it's going to be saved in my videos. I'll send a note if they want to.
And then if it's popular enough, we can have a sequel.
even without it's being popular. Do another version.
No, we don't want to offend people.
Yari, you said the. I'm looking at my questions. Oh, Alan Watts is one of the guys you quoted.
Yeah.
And.
But let me tell you, while you think of that question, my introduction to Alan Watts and Krishnamurti, which was about the same time, was very interesting because in 1982, I was studying at the university in Reno, and right around that time is when my father died in Iran, and whom I had not seen for the past 4 years of his life. My younger brother, mother, and my dad were waiting for their green card or green card interview to come here. And because at that time, you know, you needed an exit visa from Iran. Now, his exit visa came a month after he passed away. So his death was very devastating to me and, well, all of us. I left school at that time, and I got one of my first jobs, which was working at a fast food place at the Jack in the Box in Southern California.
Mm-hmm.
But I was working the late shift. Like, by the time I got home, it was like 1 or 2 a.m. And I would get into bed and put my headphones on and listen to radio at that time on KPFK. You probably knew it if you were down there. The program Roy of Hollywood.
Mm-hmm.
He would have lectures by Alan Watts and Krishnamurti like throughout the night. So at 2 or 3 in the morning, I would go to sleep with their words like almost every night. So that was a little interesting to me, at least, story in itself. Okay, you were asking about Alan Watts.
Well, as you mentioned that, I remember that that's how I was introduced to you in the Bay Area. For a long time, I was just devouring Krishnamurti.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And have you ever been to Ojai?
I've driven by it many times, but never to Ojai itself.
I've never been there too either, but it seems like a very beautiful, peaceful place.
Yeah, that was where he was. But it's interesting, actually, the first I ever read about Alan Watts was in Dariush Vaziri's Asiya dar barabar Qadr.
Oh.
That's, I never heard of him. And then years later, as I said, my introduction to his work was actually then, and in Southern California on the radio. By which time he had already passed on, I think.
Alan Watts,
yeah. Now, Krishnamurti was there for a few more years still.
Really? When did Krishnamurti pass?
I think, was it mid or late 80s?
Wow.
Yeah, in early 80s he was still there.
So yeah, those are all, they're basically concentrating on Asian thought, Taoist Buddhism.
Yeah, I mean, one of the main things that, grabbed me, what Krishnamurti was saying, that, you know, why do you go and pray to a candle in a dark room when you have the sun?
Perfect.
You know?
Right. I mean, that is, or doesn't Maulana say that?
In other ways, yes. I think Attar too.
Yeah, this sun thing, you know, we're always looking for it, but we can't look at it straight in the eye.
No, that's quite true. And I was reading, do you know the publication Parabola?
No.
It's a very interesting publication of, can't say esoteric, because spiritual matters, and maybe esoteric as well. Each issue is on a theme. And this was an interview with, I think it was Iraj Anvar, I'm not sure, was talking about how gold needs to be with an alloy to be useful. Otherwise, it's too soft by itself. You can't really use gold by itself, you know? And so it's the same with truth.
What a great analogy.
Yeah, it's amazing. It's like it is pure, but that purity is, we are incapable of taking it in. We do need an alloy.
Interesting about gold. They also say that, you know, different elements that we see in our universe, in our world, they're all like, you know, different pieces of jewelry that are made of gold. For example, a bracelet made of gold and a necklace made of gold. I don't know, a crown made of gold. They all have different functions and they look different, but they're all made of this thing called gold. And their appearance is just an appearance, but mm-hmm. essence is that gold.
Well, the raw material, yeah.
You could melt the bracelet, you could melt the necklace, and get the essence, the gold. All items are gone, but gold remains.
Right. True. So
with, I don't know, human beings, there you are, here I am, in these shapes and bodies.
Yeah. But that's true. I think that reminds me of something else that I heard Alan Watts talking about. He was talking about what is an institution. UC Berkeley, for example. Because the people change, people come and go, and an institution remains what it is with that character, which has come from human beings, but those human beings are now gone. So that's always an interesting question. That identity is formed by people, but it carries it on when people are gone or changed with other people. That's just a question, not a point.
Yeah, and you were talking about brought it to identity, and that's also an interesting question to me. You know, because a lot of people ask, are you an Iranian artist?
Right.
You know.
Oh, that's a big subject. Basically, I tell them, of course, that I am. You know, I am an Iranian American artist. I am Iranian. I have spent most of my life here. I'm hybrid, like you, like many other of our generation. Willingly or unwillingly, this is what we have become. But this takes us into this whole other neo-orientalist BS, which has been selling here for many years. You know, the Chador of the Betach de Jamshid art, which some, you know, known names are still milking after these years. Even from my teenage years, I was very much interested in this kind of modern work that has not traditional roots, but it had Iranian roots. So I was very much drawn to the work of people like Murtaza Momayez, Farshid Mesrali back then. There are a lot of the other modernists I didn't know until later, like Marco Gregorian, etc. But I was always drawn to this because I thought, you know, this is talking to me in my age, but it's talking also from where my roots are. It's not fully Western, and it's not traditional. I was always interested in that. And my work, you know, I wanted to be seen as Iranian, but not in a forced way. Because my work is Iranian plus. It's essence underneath, the kind of movement and energy that's there, to me, is Persian, is Iranian, you know, yet having to do with also what I've learned in the West, my education in art, in music history, in literature, in everything that I've learned, this all comes together. Now, it's very interesting with the kind of mode that's been prevalent in the art world. And art world, as you know, is very different than art. It's a whole different matter in general. You take any of these, right? If I throw one line of Persian calligraphy on it, it will make it into some auctions that it would normally not make it to, and the price would be, you know, 8 times the price it's now. The actual work is the same. It's about texture, it's about energies, but this kind of a banal thing that we've had to deal with and witness for years and years, it's been waning a little bit in the past few years, but still there. It's quite frustrating because there is also an intrinsic mechanism built into it that when you object to it, you're seen as being jealous. You know?
Yes.
It is kind of like the issue of Israel and anti-Semitism. It's like as soon as you criticize some wrongdoings of Israel, you're labeled anti-Semitic.
Yeah.
Same thing. You raise your voice against this neo-Orientalist BS, and it's like, oh, well, your work is not in that museum or auction selling for hundreds or tens of thousands of dollars, so you're being jealous. I mean, what do you do? What can you say?
Yeah.
And like I said, this kind of pandering to neo-Orientalists has been waning in the past few years just because, I mean, maybe they're beginning to wake up a little bit from this mess that they helped create themselves.
And another place you were talking about how Western accepts or not accepts or promotes things about the Iranian culture or the Asian, it takes it from them and then it feeds it back to us. You were saying that somewhere.
Oh, that's a different issue I was talking about in that Arterbox interview, right? It was about just this feeling of inferiority against the West that we've had for the longest time. No, I was saying that the example I used was before the revolution, which was how all of a sudden these kind of nice, colorful Baluchi outfits became fashionable.
Mm-hmm.
And it was only because the hippies had discovered them. The Western hippies, you know, coming to Iran, going to India, Afghanistan, in that area, had discovered them. And then they became popular or popularized because, and they were right under our nose the whole time.
Mm-hmm.
They were our peoples. And once they became fashionable in the West, then our people started wearing them. Our fashionable people started wearing them. That's what I was talking about. Just in general, if a Western art critic says that this artist is good, then we'll hold them in high esteem. And we don't have our own faculty to determine whether it is or not based on criteria that maybe are more homegrown or have roots in that part of the world. You know, not traditional necessarily, but I mean, that consider that culture. you know?
Yeah. So the Western observation gives it a legitimacy a little bit?
In the eye of our people, unfortunately.
Yeah.
Right? No, I was also talking about this. You know, we always look to the West. We, in all those magazines, I mean, early years, I had subscriptions to Adine magazine and Dunyaye Sohan, who were coming from Iran like every month for me. I read them cover to cover. It's always about Kafka, about George O'Keefe. And anyway, Western authors and Western schools. It's like no articles about like what's going on in the modern novel in India or yeah. or Egypt or anywhere else, or South Korea. Then, or even Turkey, you know, our neighbor. Only when one of those authors became famous in the West, then we start looking at them. Mm-hmm. Whether it was Najib Mahfouz or Orhak Pamuk, etc., etc. So that's what I was saying. And you see that in a lot of ways. You know, when the tourists in Iran, if there are people from the West, often people just bend, you know, bow to their knees to them. And yet the way we behave with other people from neighboring countries to the East, it's shameful.
Kind of would you name it like cultural insecurity? Or?
The reason, yeah, cultural insecurity would be a simplest title to put on it, but this is something that you know, anthropologists, sociologists would have to dig into further.
And then what is that? I don't really think a lot about politics, but what does that do to the current wave that's going on? You know.
What about what?
Movement, this Zan Zendegi Azadi movement. Finding some courage to, or self-confidence to say against truth.
Well, I have a lot of respect for this new generation, and I can't even put myself in their shoes of what they have gone through all these years. But since this movement began, I mean, for me, it reactivated a lot of the experiences, a lot of feelings that I've gone through in the past 44 years or so. Hard to talk about exactly how. I mean, a lot of us are going through that. We keep looking at things that are going there with cautious optimism. What will come out of it, I don't know. I have my hopes, but hopefully we can believe in the justness of history.
And I was thinking, you know, what can I do to help this cause, which is legitimate, obviously, and human need. And I'm not a person that goes out there and, you know, shakes my fist and say, you know, now, change now, you know. And I heard you also in another interview talking about we as artists do our part by just showing up in the studio and just getting into our work and make that somehow contribute to.
Well, I think artists can change the psyche of the society with time and slowly. In general, I'm not one of those artists who, you know, I mean, my work is not revolutionary work. My work is maybe you call it evolutionary work, you know, over time. And for things that need immediate response. I don't know. I mean, I don't know how to answer that question exactly, but that's not where my work is.
Yeah, well, I was saying, like, I mean, there are works that are revolutionary, that you see them, you know, and they're kind of almost just dictating something, you know, voice, writings on. But I'm thinking, could my work as just a person who is going to be present and maybe let in these revolutionary thoughts or ideology, or not ideologies, but the movement, kind of seep through me, and then maybe through me kind of go into my artwork. And then that artwork hopefully can...
I think everything we experience goes through us into our artwork. It's just like, if you want immediate result, that's a different story. This is something that I believe that takes time for it to be digested and mature and come out in a way that is not half digested, you know? Some people are more prone to doing that type of work, which is fine, and some people are not, which is fine too. You do whatever you can. You may be in this movement, your job might be to just bring tea to people who are fighting. You know, not everyone can be on the front line at the same time.
Yes.
You know, do what you can do to support. And there are other artists who do murals, for example, political murals that support that. More power to them, that's wonderful. But not everyone does that.
Yeah.
And you don't, also, we don't need everyone to do that. We have people who do that, and that's wonderful. And those are the ones who do it. Not everyone has to do everything.
Yeah, individual will... we're all made differently and contribute in different ways. You know?
Right. I mean, we want to be as effective as we can, but like I said, we have to see how best we can contribute.
You mentioned something about music, that music is a part of you. Has always been a big part of your life.
And, yes.
I think you mentioned that you also listen to music when you paint, or not anymore?
Not particularly. I do and I don't. Sometimes I listen to talk, sometimes music. But music has always been, like I said, a big part of my life. So it's really internalized. You know, like...
comes naturally.
Comes naturally, and having lived with it for so many years, I mean, Beethoven runs through my head, Bach runs through my head. Sometimes I don't even have to sit and listen. You know, I know the pieces and I know them very well, and I've lived them. They run through my veins. Sometimes, like I said, I listen to interviews, I listen to talks, it doesn't matter. Because when you're listening to a talk, there are different aspects to it. There is what's being said, there's the rhythm of the talk, there's the music of it. All these are working together at the same time. Yeah. Sometimes I might lose interest in what's being said, but the music of it will keep me going.
Yeah, this reminds me of Alan. Sometimes put Alan Watts in the background. I'm not even listening. I just like his voice.
Yeah, for example. Yeah.
And oh, what is that? You've listened to it so many times, you know every little detail of it, right. But now...
That brings up another thing, which is age, accumulation of experiences. I mean, my relationship with music is different now that I'm 61 than when I was 22. I mean, there was time in my early 20s where I was like a sponge. I would just absorb music like that. I'd love going to the record store. This was the LP days, and get a new piece of classical music record, bring it home, take out the plastic, put it on the gramophone and sit there and listen to it and make a list of the pieces that I was still missing and I needed to hear. I was such a strong sponge at that time that the effect still continues. You know, I don't need to be like that all of my life.
Right.
So, I have my older brother loves going to concerts. I mean, he goes to concerts at a crazy rate, sometimes 4 or 5 classical concerts a week. I'm not like that. I could see like one particular concert of a particular piece, and that could keep me going for a few years.
Yeah.
Now, I mean, as far as that piece goes, I mean, I go to other concerts, but like if I see a Beethoven 7th that really moved me, may not go to another Beethoven 7th concert for another 5 years or so. And I live with that. I feed off of that for years, etc. And the same here. I mean, my relationship with music, has it deepened or has it changed? I don't know which word can be used, but with age, these change. And when you're talking about the canon of classical music, for example, many of these pieces you know by heart by now.
Mm-hmm.
So, first of all, you miss that thrill of the new piece.
Yeah.
Which you don't get as much. I mean, when you go to concerts where you can hum every note from the beginning of the concert to the end, that has its own enjoyment, but you no longer have that enjoyment of discovery. You know? Anyway, this is going in a tangent, but...
No, I was coming to...
How's the drawing going?
Well, let's see.
I think it looks like me. Yes, indeed. Yep, I know that guy.
Really?
I'm trying to.
Yeah, me too. Let's see how it ends. I don't know, how much doubt do you have, Yari, when you attack at work? I'm always full of doubt and always dissatisfied. I mean, this is not at all the way I would like to draw a portrait. But no, I don't know how to do it. You know, it's just the...
Well, our way of working is different. I mean, you work figuratively, so you're looking for something else. For me, going into that kind of meditative state in the studio is basically getting rid of any doubt. It's about intention and accident, arriving at a balance between intention and accident, or managing the accident. So...
Bacon was like that, right?
John, which?
Bacon.
Yeah, well, I mean, as far as accident goes, yeah. But with intention, a lot of art, I believe, is about conviction. That when I see something down on paper or on canvas, it shows that it meant to be there. It's not wishy-washy.
Yeah.
You know? And intention is very important, because even if you're trying to show something weak, that has to be done with strong intention. Or rather, not intention in this case, conviction is the word I'm looking for, actually. And so, a few things happen when I work. Like, at first thing, I break the white, I just put something on the canvas so that I'm not staring at the white, what I call the tyranny of the white, which is where a lot of artists get blocks, or writers too, looking at the white page. And once that white is broken, then the next step I'm taking is a response to what I did earlier, this mark, Now you have two marks or two actions happening on the piece. And then the next thing is the reaction to those two, and then more and more. Just exponentially, it gets deeper and deeper. And at some point, to me, the work is successful when synergy happens, when, you know, the whole becomes greater than the sum of its parts. Some kind of a new breath of life comes into the work. Now, there's a lot of back and forth between that before that happens. And one of the dangers to me is that sometimes the work gets too pretty, you know. Qashang dar miyad, khoshke dar miyad, and you go, but it doesn't have that breath of life. Un nadare tush. And that's where I intentionally push it in a different direction. I just take a rag with paint or something, just put it on there, just to bring it, shock it out of that prettiness. Not beauty. Beauty is what I'm after, but not prettiness. And that gets it back on the track. Gets it back on track to where beauty can be also a component of the finished work. So synergy, in one word, is what I work towards. Doubt, whenever doubts arise, I mean, it gives rise to emotion. You know, if I put something on canvas, I'm doubtful of its presence and why it's there, and I'm going to alter it. Put something.
Yeah.
House over it. So doubt is a part of this moving engine, but it doesn't have to be a hindrance. It could be a catalyst for movement, you know. But this way, it doesn't stay that long. It comes, it gives rise to emotion, to an action, and dissipates, may come back, and the same thing happens.
And it takes some brave action to, if you see something that is, quote, pretty, and you're after beauty,
right,
to destroy the pretty, because a lot of people look at that and say, well, why did you, that looks good.
Exactly, exactly. It does take courage as an artist to do that. And something I came up with that is that you can never ruin a painting if you dare to ruin it. Yeah. You know, because it would always respond and always come back to you. You see, years ago, I was working at the gallery at the university that I was at. And I was given the task of cutting some large sheets of glass for framing some pieces. So my boss showed me how to do it. You take the glass cutter, you do this, you turn it around, you hit the glass, straight, clean line. I kept doing that, and it would break right in the middle. You know, this curved line right in the middle of the glass. And the boss came back and said, well, this keeps happening. He said, oh, you're not using the zen of cutting glass. I said, okay, what is it? Show me. And he did it, he cut it, he turned the sheet of glass over the other side and very strongly just hit it. He said, you have to do it very determinedly and without fear. If it senses your fear, it will break.
Crazy, right?
If you show fear, it would break. And it's very true, because it's glass, you think you have to handle it gingerly, and that's exactly why it breaks. You know, so Fadai, Janab Fadai.
How are you? Time? Are you okay?
No, I'm doing fine. Yeah. So that was interesting. So the same thing. You have to dare. This I also learned from Francis Bacon, that whenever you get stuck in a painting, paint out the part you like most, because you. actually that's what's keeping it from coming together, because you forget that what's the most important is the totality of the piece, not a certain area that looks wonderful. Yeah. You know? So, but we often hang on to that because we really love this part of the painting, and so we wonder why the rest of it is not coming together. So this idea of, to me, actually first I learned it from him, and then I experienced it more and more, and you become more and more daring as you go on doing that.
And they see that, you know, and appreciate it. You know, they see something that is fresh and exciting and new. They don't know what it is, but it is, you know, what you described, that, you know, when you bring the truth in it and you cared and you forget about yourself, and
yeah, it
comes through, and people appreciate and buy your paintings.
Yeah, art is about this kind of totality, this kind of a self-sustained organism, that unit that works as a whole, and not about like little nice little areas here or there that looks wonderful. If you really love that and you can't bring yourself to paint it out, well, then cut it out and make it its own paint, you know.
Yeah, and then so you know, you need to have the feeling of freedom, and that's why sometimes it gives me you know, it draws me back when I'm drawing a portrait, especially a commissioned portrait, you know, because I'm the person who commissioned the portrait. And then I can see how horrible the painting is because I'm trying to please, you know, and I don't have the, I'm not brave enough to attack it. And
well, why not?
No.
What?
Why not?
No, you see, this reminds me, there was this, when I was at school in San Francisco, there was this amazing, very young, very talented painter whose realistic work was amazing.
Yeah. Yeah.
But so amazing that I think it actually bothered him as well. So he would do these beautiful faces, beautifully painted, and then he would scratch and scrape and smudge paint on them and then build them up again.
Yeah.
And do that again and do that again. Just keep do this push and pull. I mean, with your own work I'm talking about, and then see what happens. Don't assume a straight line from beginning to the end of the painting. You know, do this. Maybe at some point during the painting, turn it upside down and work on it upside down. Throw some other color on it that's not even in the painting. And then you would have to go and wipe it off and do something with it. Because of the detritus, this overlap, the push and pull, some new energy comes into the work. And then you can refine that into the final painting. You see what I mean? It's like you don't have to follow like this, for example, the Renaissance recipe of this step and then this step, and then you put in the highlights and then you put in the shadows and then you do this. You don't have to do that.
Yeah.
And you can end up with what you want, but even more powerful and more resonant.
Actually, the portraits that I do that I'm satisfied with are exactly what you described. That, you know, then you just attack it and you make mistakes and you paint over it, and then, you know, it keeps building up and up, and then, you know, some of that history shows through.
Yeah.
Your work is like that too. I mean, it's just full of history and.
Well, and my work is more open to that, of course, right? But you see, it's interesting. At one of my shows, like somebody asked me, "Well, what were you feeling when you did this painting?" It's like completely impossible for me to answer because this is an amalgamation of layers of time and history. It's like I worked on this piece over, let's say, 6 months, in layers and in between these other paintings that I'm working on. That they come together and a layer was washed off and then another one put on and then this here, that. So it's not like one sitting to say that I was happy on that day or I was sad on that day. This is like not a slice of, or let's say it's not a slice of life in this way. It's a slice of life in this way where many different layers come together. Yep. Does it that make sense?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. It's basically kind of like art and life are so similar, you know? Life is like that too, you know? You're just struggling and you don't give up and you go back and back.
Very much so. Yeah, very much so. I've learned so much from the studio that I've used in my life outside the studio. I just need to learn even more.
That's the thing about, you know, being an artist, you know, having the privilege of being in a studio and dealing with these things, you know, that's what I die for. I live for, I should say.
Yeah, well, that's what I mean when I say that when I'm not painting, I feel off-centered, you know. And that's another thing, like somebody said some time ago, oh, it must be so wonderful that you paint, this and that. And said, not necessarily. It's not about joy or lack of joy. It's just about something you have to do.
Yeah.
It's like breathing. You don't stop and say, although it's a good idea to stop and say, I enjoy breathing. But breathing you just do because you have to, you know. And art is like that. Is it joyful? Yes. Is it joyful? No. Is it painful? Sometimes yes, sometimes no. It just doesn't even have to do with those concepts at all.
Yes.
It's something else. Yeah, for me, it's like that. It's, you see, each one of us has as a their own contribution to make to this world with their art. None of us are the same. If you and I worked in the same style, our work would be different.
Yeah.
If I throw paint in some way on the canvas and you throw the paint differently, and if I approach that thrown paint and do something with it, if you approach it, you do something different with it. And so, see, I'm amazed at all these. I always look forward to the work that's coming out. I have no idea what will come out next. And that's what keeps me going. When I look at this work now, I go, five years ago, if I'd seen this somewhere, I wouldn't have known this would be my work.
Mm.
And that's exciting to me. And I have no idea where this will take me 5 years from now, if I'm still here. So that's one of the reasons that I work so much, because it's like time is limited and I need to get these out as much as possible. One of the reasons. So yeah, it is wonderful in a way that, I mean, I also love the fact that you come into the studio and you leave the studio, you think you've been there for 20 minutes and your wife tells you, oh, you know, how was the last 6 hours? You know? And you think, oh, really? I was 20 minutes in there. So this is what I love. And actually, it brings me to another point, which so I realized that I can bring down what I want my work to do into one sentence, basically, that what I want it to do, or when it's successful, when it does this, is when it stops time.
Yes.
When you stand in front of it, you look at it, you feel the sense of timelessness. How and why, I don't know. And how can you put your finger on it? No. But when it does that, that gives me a very good feeling that it has arrived where I wanted it to go.
Timelessness basically is, you know, my goal is, when I approach an artwork, is to search for the truth. The truth is what we talked about in the beginning about that we cannot define, the gold in the jewelry. Coming to the studio every day is to be in that presence of that.
Yeah, you know? Exactly. In meditation also it talks about the same thing, that the truth is not something to be found. It's already there. By silencing the mind, by silencing everything, you allow it to be seen. It's not something to achieve. It's just something you get at by getting rid of this other thing. It's the same thing. Timelessness, that stillness, and the rest is right in front of us.
And so when you were talking about you want your painting to be timeless or show timelessness, you're basically painting this energy, which is time.
Exactly, energy. Because, you know, energy, that energy, this energy that I'm interested in, the energy is Sarchishmas, you know, the energy before it becomes something. Like the energy, I talk about poetry in my work a lot, you know, about the poetic nature of work. It's not poetry, it's about that energy before it becomes a poem. It's about that energy before it becomes music. You know, that original energy. And to me, that's actually a very good definition of God, to me.
Thank you. And that is how God manifests itself through these different venues, whether it's music or art or you know, a good business, a proper business, whatever, is God basically through the creator of that entity.
Yeah.
Comes through.
Yeah, devoid of ornamentation, yes.
Because he doesn't have any, or it doesn't have any definition. So it manifests through this mortal human being.
Yeah. Maybe that's the alloy it needs. Like gold, you know?
Oh my God. We have to sit down and write a book, Yari. Robert, two different things.
You know, one of my most favorite movies of all time. Do you know My Dinner with Andre?
Yes, yes. Ah. Somebody else?
We can do something like that.
one of the people like, he's a photographer. It's his favorite. But remind me, I saw it like early 80s or something, right?
Oh, I've seen it probably more than any other movie I've ever seen, probably maybe 27 times. It's just two people sitting and talking for 2.5 hours. But it's amazing. And it is one of those things. I first saw it on a rainy day in Berkeley, and I thought 20 minutes had gone by and the movie was over. I said, what was this it? I came out, it was like 2.5 hours.
But
to see it over and over, because there was just so much in it that couldn't be absorbed with one watching.
Right.
Oh, you have to watch it. It's easily available on many different places. At My Dinner with Andre. And although it's maybe more than 40 years old now, it's still very relevant.
Oh, I know. Who is a famous screenwriter that wrote that, right? He does Broadway shows?
No, Louis Malle was the movie director who did that. And Andre Gregory himself, who plays himself, he was a very important avant-garde theater director who was in Iran, too, for the Shiraz Art Festival.
No kidding.
Yeah, I was just finishing his memoirs, actually. It talks about his experience in Iran. Yeah. I got a chance to see him at a play reading in L.A. a few years ago, and it was wonderful. At that time, it was 25 years after I'd seen the movie. I go up to him afterwards, and I say, there is something I've been meaning to get from you for 25 years. He goes, what? I said, a hug. He gave me a very nice big hug. You have to watch that movie.
I would love to. I've seen it. I just need to review it.
Ah, okay. I even had it on cassette years ago. I would listen to it when I was painting.
What? You said we talked about music. You sing, I think, right?
Not for a while, but I sang for many years in choirs, yes. Classical choirs, yeah.
And not recently, you don't do any?
Not any, I mean, you know, since the pandemic, everything kind of became up in the air. And I might join another choir again. But usually what happened is that I would get very busy and then I would leave it and then I would miss it and go back and then get busy again and the cycle would continue. But I miss it now, so hopefully within the next few months I can join another one in the area here.
So you sing like a, is it a choir?
Yes. Well, before it was San Francisco Choral Society, and then where I am now, also Berkeley Community Chorus, I was with before. And I have to do some research. There may be other ones in the area that I don't know about yet.
And for that, I'm sure you have to practice. You have to, you can't just say, okay, now I want to go and play with the friends. You have to keep your voice.
Yeah, well, what that's what you do in the rehearsals with the choir. You just kind of, you always start with the warm-ups and then gradually get into the piece. Yeah.
But like at home, do you sing?
Normally, you don't have to practice at home. Like the rehearsal for choir work, maybe for solo work, you have to do some extra rehearsals at home. But rehearsing, practicing with the whole choir is usually fine. And usually, you do it with the choir and the piano throughout the season, and at the concert with the choir and orchestra.
Yeah, I was going to ask you to maybe show us an example of one of your, maybe a
I have some on my YouTube channel, actually, but those videos are from my student days. Some of them are more than 30 years old with the choir.
Maybe you could sing something small now or no?
No. I'm a shy singer. I let my voice go when I'm with a group. The smaller the group gets, the more tight my voice gets. I have terrible stage fright, except when I'm on stage with like 200 other people, then I can really let go.
Well, I think this has gone on for almost, 2 hours.
Really? Wow. Good.
Thank you so much. I don't know if you'd be willing to join me again, because I thoroughly enjoyed talking to you.
I did too, but anything else left to talk about? I think we finished the whole thing.
There's limitless amount of things to talk about.
Well, no, thank you. I thank you again for your invitation. I enjoyed our talk, and I hope our meandering has not bored anyone. There's no money back guaranteed, people. So anyway, any complaints, you should talk to him.
Anything else you want to tell people about, how to look for you online or?
Oh, well, I'm easy to find online if you just Google my name. Both my site and other sites where my work is available on come up, so very easy to do that. And then the link to the videos, interviews, either text interviews or video audio, those are all on my site under media, I think.
Yeah. Wonderful. Any you don't have any shows coming up?
We have a group show actually in Sausalito, a very good group show that was put together by Shiva Paktel. She's an artist and curator here in the Bay Area. And that is actually closing this Sunday. I have the open studios to do here the month after. My work will be in the Hampstead Art Fair in London, mid-March through Noon Powell Gallery, this gallery in London I work with. And working early stages of a show in Paris, but that's really in the very early stages, hasn't come together yet. Working on that for next fall. Next year, I'll be having a show in Germany, in Leverkusen, which is near Köln. The rest, there's some things that, just like I said, are very, they're just in a germinating stage, very early stages.
Sweet. I hope you come back and tell us more about those when...
Thank you. I will. Thank you so much for this. I really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, everyone, for being here. Thank you so much.
See you.
Bye.